Hi, I'm Jim Heath, and I'm the president of the Institute for Systems Biology. I'm here with Daniel Chen and Yapeng Su, two of my co-authors on a paper that we recently published in Cell. Another one of the lead co-authors was Dan Yuan, who's not here right now. And in this paper, what we wanted to do was to understand the condition called long COVID. Another term for it is post-acute sequelae from COVID-19, which is a mouthful and often just shortened to PASC, P-A-S-C. We wanted to study long COVID because it's many, many patients, and maybe even up to a third or more patients that have COVID-19 will have chronic conditions following disease. And those chronic conditions can be neurological, they can be respiratory, it can be difficulty to exercise, the list goes on. And so we wanted to understand, what is it that puts the patients at risk of having those a long COVID or PASC? And are there interventions that one could possibly employ? And so to this end, we studied several hundred patients at a very, very high level of depth, from taking their symptoms to looking at individual immune cells and circulating their body, to try to understand long COVID. And in fact, we were able to identify a number of factors that anticipate PASC. We call them PASC factors. And very surprisingly, most of those factors could be measured at the time that the patient is diagnosed with COVID-19 infection. Meaning as early in the infection course as you can go, we can see these factors that anticipate PASC. And one set of these factors had to do with viral loads in the blood. And Yapeng, maybe you could tell us a little bit about that.
Yes, absolutely. So as Jim said, the viral load is one important early factor that we can measure near the diagnosis to predict long COVID symptoms. In fact, before our study was performed, people has been suspecting that it's actually when the patient are suffering from long COVID that their body still have the viral fragment which are associated with the long COVID. But when we do the measurement, we find it's actually the early blood viral measurement that are strongly associated with certain long COVID symptoms. So regarding viral fragment of SARS-CoV-2 virus itself, actually in addition to that, we find another virus, not SARS-CoV-2, it's called EBV, are actually their fragment early on in the disease are also significantly associated with later long COVID symptoms. And most times they are being controlled by our immune system, so they are not activated, they are latent. What we do find is that there is a subset of patients, even in the diagnosis stage, their EBV is no longer latent. They get firing up, and those fraction of the patient are the ones that have higher risk for later long COVID. And that's probably related to how the SARS-CoV-2 virus infection is dysregulating our immune system, so our immune system can no longer properly control that originally latent EBV virus, and then the reactivated EBV virus is making things worse and leading to long COVID symptoms.
And it's also striking that EBV, which is Epstein-Barr virus, is the virus most associated with mononucleosis, which, as you know, many of us as teenagers might have gotten it. It's called the kissing disease, but it puts you flat on your back with fatigue for a month or more, and which is, you know, not that different from some long COVID symptoms. Another past factor that we found had to do with autoantibodies. So when you're vaccinated or when you have had SARS-CoV-2, your body will naturally develop antibodies against the virus, and those are protective. Your body can also develop autoantibodies, which you'll see oftentimes in autoimmune disease, like lupus. But those autoantibodies basically are antibodies that attack and bind to proteins that your own body makes, and so they're detrimental to health. And what did we find, Daniel?
Yeah, so what we found is that a lot of patients with high autoantibodies simultaneously have low antibodies that neutralize SARS-CoV-2. And that's going to make them more susceptible to breakthrough infections because they have less neutralizing potential if they get reinfected.
So you mean as autoantibodies go up, SARS-CoV-2 antibodies go down.
Exactly.
Protection goes down. Well, so when we looked at these autoantibodies, we were looking at autoantibodies against proteins specifically related to immune responses and also lupus. And maybe you can comment on that a little bit.
Sure. So the autoantibodies we looked at, one targets interferon, which is a key component in antiviral responses in your body. So it basically just shuts that down. And the other autoantibodies we looked at are related to autoimmune diseases like lupus, which target tissue and anti-cell-based materials. And what we found there is that a lot of patients have high levels of these autoantibodies, but they aren't formally diagnosed with an autoimmune disease.
That's right. I think only maybe 5 to 8% of the patients that had autoantibodies had any history of autoimmune disease, which just tells you that, those, oftentimes you can have sort of some molecular features of a disease, but there's no symptoms, and it's called subclinical, and that's the case in these patients. Something we also found is that even if you have mild COVID-19, there's a pretty high, you got pretty good odds of having long COVID. Not as good as if you had severe disease. I want to be sure before we close to say, number one, that this was a very large collaboration. It was a collaboration with physicians and the Providence system and at University of Washington. We had scientists from every place, from UCLA to Stanford to UCSF to the Hutch to UW, give us guidance and collaborate with us on how to analyze this stuff. And we had collaborators who were the patients. And that's a really big deal. We asked for upwards of 400 patients or something to come in over multiple time points to give us blood, to tell us how they felt, to give us symptoms, to answer questionnaires. We cannot do this work without patients' participation, and we are extremely grateful for that. Thank you.